Tough Topics in Ethnogeriatrics, sponsored by the Stanford Geriatric Education Center in collaboration with the California Area Health Education Centers, American Geriatric Society, and the Natividad Medical Center. My name is Christopher Matola, and I will be your host for this session. We are very happy to have you join with us today as we present the program on an ethnogeriatric perspective on health literacy and medication use in emergency preparedness. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen. The presenters will respond to the questions in the Q&A session at the end of their presentations. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At the conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education credits for attending the webinar, the evaluation is required. We need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial interest, and today's presenters have no financial relationships to disclose. And now I would like to introduce Dr. Melen McBride, Associate Director Emerita and Advanced Practice Nurse in Ethnogeriatrics. She continues to provide leadership in the development of ethnogeriatric curricula, programs, and resources in emergency preparedness specific to older adults from diverse groups and represents the Center of the Geriatric Emergency Preparedness Response Collaborative, GEPR, of six HRSA-funded GECs. She facilitates the GEPR/SGEC-EP webinar series. And now for Melen.
When Homeland Security was created after the 9/11 disaster, the National Association of GECs initiated a survey of GECs and found a lack of geriatric curricula and resources on emergency preparedness. A position statement was presented to HRSA on the need for training. HRSA's response was to provide supplemental funding for multidisciplinary geriatric emergency preparedness training. Six GECs received support to train health professionals on bioterrorism and emergency preparedness in aging. Later, an all-hazard approach was adopted, and the BTEPA group evolved into the Geriatric Emergency Preparedness and Response Collaborative. For the current GEC grant cycle, the collaborative proposed to provide more preparedness training, and three GECs committed to offer training through the SGEC webinar series program. These are our learning objectives for today. My talk will focus on the association between health literacy and medication use in the context of disaster preparedness and special needs of ethnic minority older adults. Doctors Stemley and O'Neill Gant will discuss specific issues, preparedness strategies, practice tips, and resources. To the best of our knowledge, this is the first formal training program for healthcare providers on an important aspect of survival among ethnic minority elders with health literacy issues relative to emergency preparedness to stay healthy before, during, and after a disaster by meeting healthcare needs such as having adequate supply of medication and accessing healthcare in time of limited resources. As we continue our presentation, please be thinking of your questions as we go through the presentation. If you have a burning question while I am presenting, please write it down in the chat box and send it to everyone. I'll try to respond at an appropriate time. The Institute of Medicine's definition is presented here on the slide with compelling facts that need urgent attention in preparedness programs. Consider that there are 47 million who speak a non-English language at home, and think about an older Cambodian refugee with limited English proficiency and little formal education who is attempting to put together a personal preparedness pack using an emergency preparedness checklist. What kind of help would this person need? Another term closely related to health literacy is functional health literacy, defined in this slide. These are complex activities, and reducing health risks would be one of the key goals of emergency preparedness. Consider what an older Mexican American might have to be prepared for a disaster if she or he lives in an urban area, has a GED certificate, and is reasonably healthy. There are five areas of functional health literacy which are listed on this slide. And actually, a sixth domain should be added, which is technology, internet, and computer literacy. The basic fundamental domains and scientific literacy are the two domains that I will talk about. First, about reading labels and health literacy. Primary care patients in a Shreveport health center were asked to explain what they understood from the directions of prescription warning labels. Some had simple directions and others were complex instructions. Davis and Associates found single step labels were better understood than multiple step directions. Almost everyone had difficulty with multi-step directions. The low literacy patients, those who are at the sixth grade or less reading level, had difficulty with the warning labels. And they were also more likely to make incorrect interpretations. Let us think about an older American Indian who may be marginally literate and lives near a nuclear plant, attempting to understand written directions on how to prevent radiation exposure and what to do if exposed. What kind of assistance might this person need? Another study is a longitudinal study of English cohorts who were given a four-item test to assess their understanding of written instructions for taking aspirin. The lower functional health literacy score was associated with these variables listed on the slide. However, it was not associated with ethnicity. Perhaps if the non-white data is disaggregated, the results may be different. Let's talk a little bit about scientific literacy, which is reported in the literature, and 5 to 15% of the U.S. population is considered to be science literate. I consider this number a little bit low. We could do better, and at least 63% of Americans do not know the difference between a virus and a bacteria. Consider the implications for citywide health education to prepare for epidemics such as H1N1 flu virus, or in the case of those who are not well informed about what a clinical trial is, then explaining the clinical trials, why the importance of conducting it before a vaccine or antibiotic is used for mass distribution may need to be framed in such a way that it is widely understood in the community. I seem to have lost my control for the slides. Okay, here we go. Sorry. The next slide is still related to scientific literacy and a cross-national study of knowledge about Alzheimer's was made and using a short survey questionnaire administered to four groups of ethnic older adults. The results suggest that certain ethnic minority groups do not have sufficient information about Alzheimer's disease, which may explain the low usage of services. Might this be true also with similar ethnic minority groups with regards to seeking assistance for emergency preparedness? Now, I've summarized here the risk factors that we have discussed earlier that may influence health literacy: age, income, education, membership to a minority group, recent immigrants, born in the U.S. but may have limited English proficiency, and English as a second language. What is the relationship then of being belonging to an ethnic group or a cultural group or having limited English proficiency in emergencies? Donovan, in an extensive review of literature and various government and private reports on emergency preparedness, highlights the lack of attention to the experiences of people from diverse cultures and persons with limited English proficiency. Some of the consequences of this neglect include not getting important information about emergencies, failing to receive needed services, including medical assistance, and experiencing poorer outcomes. Many reports on the lessons learned after Katrina noted the importance of including special needs populations in planning, response, and recovery efforts for those efforts to be successful. These are some key areas that health literacy links to emergency preparedness: developing appropriate, understandable written information and resources about emergency preparedness are necessary, especially for older adults with low literacy from diverse cultural groups. There are many types of emergencies and public health emergencies. There are many kinds of information, directions, maps, and guidance, plus understanding the effects of the different types of disaster are complex information to be understood. Health maintenance involving nutrition, hydration, and medication, and accessing an effective use of medical care during this period of evacuation, sheltering in, or recovery are issues that are going to be discussed by Drs. Stemley and O'Neill Grant. These are a list of low literacy behaviors that relate to medication use. In healthcare settings, service agencies, and evacuation shelters, these behaviors specific to medication use may need further assessment to prevent complications. The last item in particular requires careful evaluation of the ethnic elder's ability to avoid incorrect dosages in a personal preparedness kit. This may also involve assessing the skill of a caregiver if the ethnic elder is receiving care from a family caregiver or a paid caregiver. There are also low literacy behavior cues that would need further assistance to tailor personal preparedness education to an ethnic elder with limited literacy. Understanding and acting on these cues as part of the healthcare provider's pre-disaster plan for an ethnic elder would be a highly desirable preventive intervention. And here are also some low health literacy outcomes that have been reported in the literature. The fourth one in particular, less adherence to medical regimen in a non-emergency situation may be carried over into a disaster situation, which could compromise the older person's chances of surviving a crisis during a disaster or at the recovery phase. The next two slides present support for increased mortality associated with low health literacy. A prospective study of community-dwelling older adults in Memphis, Tennessee and Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, who were without functional difficulties or dementia, showed higher risk for death among those with limited literacy. And limited literacy was independently associated with mortality on a nearly twofold increase. I'm going back to the longitudinal study of English cohorts, and this study also showed that for those with the lowest functional health literacy score were likely to die in 5 years. And this is just simply about the written instruction for taking an aspirin tablet. And consider the possibility of complicated instructions related to emergency preparedness and what might be their chances in surviving a major disaster or a crisis during a personal or health crisis during a disaster. Access to prescription drugs in disaster preparedness may be addressed with the following resources. They are resources to help improve the ability of individuals to receive prescription medications in disaster preparedness. The ethnic elder with low functional health literacy may need education on how local pharmacists in the community can be effective resources in preparing a personal preparedness plan. Instructions about mass dispensing by home delivery, sites for mass prophylaxis, through written or oral form via radio announcements or newspapers, must be in simple and understandable language. The city's readiness initiative, which is a program designed to assist cities in increasing their capacity to deliver medicines and medical supplies during a large-scale public health emergency, is a program that works with communities to create plans for points of distribution to provide, say, for example, antibiotics, vaccines, or other emergency medications or medical supplies. Ideally, being aware of ways of dispensing medication and medical supplies in a disaster and how public resources function helps to improve the ethnic elders' ability to empower themselves and become effective advocates to reduce the risk to their health and stay healthy in a disaster. The next slides are where you can get more information about these resources. These links are highly informative, and if you also have time to go to the link of the ECHO organization in Minnesota, Those two links are videotapes, and they are very useful and very interesting. RAND Corporation also has a very important report on the city's readiness initiative. And please go and visit the site and download the report. We are not given authorization to put this on our website, but we certainly can encourage you to go to the RAND Corporation site. Lastly, we request your participation by responding to this question so that we can get an idea of your contacts with older adults who may have limited functional health literacy. This will also help Dr. Stemley and Dr. O'Neill Grant to address some of the possible kinds of issues that might come up. Thank you for your responses, and it looks like for those who responded, 13% of the 45%, no, yeah, 45% of the respondents said less than 5, no, 29%, I think, yes, okay, less than 5%. I mean, less than 5 older adults that you see in a given week. And if they were all unrepeated cases in a month, you'll be seeing about 20 patients or 20 older adults with functional health literacy. Thank you very much for this information. It's certainly very informative, and it gives us a kind of a peek into the amount of work that health providers and those who are providing services to ethnic elders with low health literacy, there's a lot of work to be done. It is now my pleasure to present to you our next speaker, Dr. Edward Stemley.
Basically, I just wanted to thank you for being here, for allowing me to be here to talk to you a little bit about emergency situations that restrict access to health care, and thus giving our patients some guidelines on self-care during those times. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about, I just want to preface this slide a bit with the fact that there's tons of information available on emergency preparedness, particularly before and after disasters, and the resources that are available before and after disasters. We would like to focus on emergency preparedness immediately before disasters, during disasters, and immediately after. And that's the time frame where there's more risk of restriction to access to health care. And so we'd like to focus on that time frame because of this restriction that we may have to health care, and thus requiring the patient to care for themselves or to practice self-care. For the purposes of this presentation, I like to define self-care as the management of one's own existing chronic conditions and acute health care conditions that may arise during emergency situations. This is all going to be related to, the self-care will be related to situations where victims of disasters immediately before, during, and immediately after don't have access to health care and required to pretty much take care of themselves. So when we talk about the three P's to determine a need for self-care, we're really describing situations where patients are in isolation, whether that be sheltering in place or at some type of emergency or medical shelter, or even in transit during a disaster immediately before when they are, before they actually get to a place where they have access to health care. So some of the things that we need to consider are the three P's, as I call them, that we need to consider when educating patients on the need to shelter in place or shelter or during transit, the need to provide self-care for themselves. It's really proximity, predictability, and preparedness. Proximity would be proximity of the disaster to that victim, and also how widespread or isolated the disaster is in the area that the patient may be sheltering or lives. Predictability is basically how predictable is the disaster? Will the patients have any warning? And if so, how much warning would they need or have to determine whether they can evacuate before the disaster strikes? And preparedness relates directly to the patient's ability to have the financial resources, emergency kits, and other resources that they may need to evacuate or prepare to remove themselves from that situation and into a situation where they have access to health care. So we want to take things from that perspective. And when we are educating patients and helping them to prepare for disasters, these are some of the things that we need to consider, because as we will see in a few minutes later slides, that some patients, especially the geriatric population, just have inherent needs to be at home and shelter in place and not evacuate. And so part of the education needs to be helping those patients decide in which situations that they would need to evacuate and go into areas where they do have access to health care. So just as an example, we have, I've pulled some basic information from FEMA's website, ready.gov, to share with you just some basic situations: hurricanes, tornadoes, earthquakes, wildfires, and even some declared disasters like technological disasters and hazardous materials that may be released into the atmosphere, to illustrate how we can utilize the three P's to educate patients on the need to evacuate if possible. So hurricanes, let's talk about hurricanes. Basically, the damage from hurricanes can be widespread, as we have significant wind damage and tropical storms, which may cause flooding as well. I guess the good thing, if we can call it a good thing, about hurricanes is that they're very predictable. You can have up to 48 to 96 hours notice that a hurricane is possible. And so in this case, you know, we have a lot of warning for the disaster. And so if the third P, preparedness, if a patient's prepared to evacuate at the time of a hurricane or at the time of that warning, then we would certainly encourage them to do so and not shelter in place, even if they their inherent desire and culture is to shelter in place. Tornadoes are a little different. There's a lot of wind damage, but I guess the difference in tornadoes from hurricanes is that it's very isolated. Damage can affect miles of territory, but it's not as widespread that some of the area healthcare facilities are unreachable. And so for that reason, we would consider them to be very isolated. There's no predictability sometimes for tornadoes. We can suspect when a tornado might occur, since they're associated with thunderstorms, and so they are kind of seasonal. But as far as predictability, it's related to thunderstorms, and if we can give some warning about the possibility of a tornado, it's probably more hours than than days, as we see with hurricanes. So in a lot of these cases, patients, you would basically educate your patients to be ready to shelter in place, because it really won't have enough notice, even if they are prepared to evacuate, to get out safely. Earthquakes and wildfires are just two other examples of disasters that are natural disasters that we really don't have much warning. So how prepared a patient is to evacuate really won't matter. So the preparation is really geared toward sheltering in place, or if you can find a safe house or shelter, emergency shelter, getting to that shelter, you know, as soon as possible before the disaster or even during the disaster. Earthquakes, they've been proven in the literature to be impossible to predict at all. And so there's really no way that, you know, a patient could plan for evacuation from an earthquake. So we really have to guide our patients to shelter in place, or most times in that situation. Wildfires, you know, we can, just looking at the setting and the environment that victims may be in, or potential victims, we can predict and kind of plan for wildfires in those areas, and maybe seasonal as well. But in most cases, when a fire ignites, you don't have much notice about the fire. So I think most of the guidance that we would give to patients with this type of disaster would be how to shelter in place, or a safe way to get to the nearest emergency shelter. Earthquakes, unlike wildfires, will cause and can cause widespread disaster. So even if you survive an earthquake, it could be days or weeks before you have access to health care, and that's just important to know when we are planning for self-care, which we'll talk about in more detail later. Wildfires, on the other hand, similar to tornadoes, they're more isolated, and I mean, they may cover miles of territory, but usually there is a healthcare organization that's unaffected that will allow access to healthcare in you know, a reachable area. Let's try a poll, and I just like to introduce this case with the associated questions to make sure that, you know, we understand the P3s, the 3 P's, and how to apply those and guide patients in that area. So we have an 84-year-old African-American female with early onset of dementia who is married to an 80-year-old African-American male with hypertension, type 2 diabetes, and secondary retinopathy and renal insufficiency. The couple, after being prompted by family members to, admit themselves to a long-term care facility or a retirement home where there's some help, refused that admission and currently live at home in Gulfport, Mississippi on the coast. The couple does have an evacuation plan, being that they're on the coast, and the emergency kit, which includes emergency supplies but not medications. So there's a couple of things that we can infer, from this case. One being that there's some cultural and social barriers here with this couple, this elderly couple, wanting to stay in their own homes and be independent, given the health conditions that they have. So that's one thing that we might consider here. Another thing that we might consider here is that there might be some health literacy, as we learned from Dr. McBride's presentation, just the understanding on how and what medications they should take and how they should take them. You'll see that in preparing an emergency kit that this couple neglected to put any medications in their emergency kit. And so we don't know for sure, but we can infer that there might be some health literacy issues here going on that caused them not to include that into their emergency kit. So just some background information on the case so that we have a good understanding of, you know, what we're dealing with and why patients like these, just under normal circumstances that want independence and want to stay at home in a disaster situation, probably would not want to evacuate as well, given that culture. So going to the question, the poll question, the National Weather Service has just issued a Category 2 hurricane warning for the Mississippi coastline, to make landfall within 48 hours. So we do have some warning here. Based on the three P's, should the couple shelter in place and thus engage in health care and self-care? So if they're sheltering in place and not having access, their health care is, the access is restricted, should this couple engage in health care based on what we've learned about the P3s? So I would ask that you take a couple of minutes to just give your opinion on that using the multiple choice questions listed here. Okay. Do I have control here? Well, the responses to the poll is very accurate. So the correct answer, with over 60% of the poll responding, is C. No, the hurricane warning has provided sufficient time to evacuate. And actually, you know, there might be some cases where someone might consider that there is not enough time or not enough warning to evacuate, with the answer A. And hurricanes typically causing isolated damage. They could cause isolated damage, but for the most part, in what we talked about with the three P's, hurricanes generally can cause widespread damage. So, you know, we want to prepare for the worst case. And so having this couple not engage in self-care, and in other words, not sheltering in place, or finding an emergency shelter, but finding an area, evacuating to an area where they do have unlimited access to health care would be, you know, the most appropriate answer here. So I think we are all on the same page with the guidance that we should be providing patients. And I think that's one of the things that I want to emphasize, that you will need to guide patients because of some of the social and cultural barriers that we talked about that may motivate patients to try to shelter in place. And we see that year after year, especially on the coastlines, that we have the same people that are victims of disasters that continually shelter in place and, you know, and try to survive the storm. So part of our education should be really educating patients, particularly the geriatric population, on the need to evacuate to an area where their health care is not restricted. Thank you for your responses on that. So let's move on and talk about a couple of examples in detail that illustrates what we're trying to convey here. Okay. So we'll use the example of Hurricane Katrina, which is pretty close to me. I actually was practicing pharmacy administration in Houston, Texas, when the storm occurred, and developed a pharmacy and healthcare system to accommodate the health care for 25,000 evacuees from the New Orleans, Baton Rouge, just the Louisiana, southern Louisiana area. And, of course, this is my hometown as well, New Orleans is, and I am back practicing teaching at Xavier University and practicing administration there as well. So why not use Hurricane Katrina as an example of what we're trying to convey here in terms of preparing victims of disasters to practice self-care. So typically, looking at this picture, you have a couple of hurricane victims on the rooftops of their homes, where if just looking at the picture without me describing it or mentioning anything, I think it's pretty evident that healthcare is access to healthcare is restricted. There's no healthcare in sight, no way for these folks to obtain any healthcare, and the situation that they're in could take from hours for rescue to a matter of days to a matter of weeks for the water to subside and for them to be able to get to an area where they can receive healthcare. Obviously, even if they had access to healthcare, the first priority for these victims is survival. And most times, victims of disasters don't associate survival with poor health management. So survival for them is, I'm going to be without food or water, you know, for some period of time, and, you know, I need those things to survive. I don't think they think about, well, maybe I have a heart condition and just the stress of this whole environment could cause me to have a massive heart attack or something like that, and I don't think they think about that during that situation. So there is a great need for us to educate patients in this area, especially during hurricanes. I've seen personally victims of disasters really have a problem with healthcare management during this immediate time of the disaster, right before and during and immediately after the disaster. You know, self-care is imminent in this case. For whatever amount of time that these victims are going to be here and not rescued, they will need to take care of themselves in the absence of a healthcare provider, and will need guidance on how they should do that. Just to further illustrate the point, this is the same disaster 2 months later. So to illustrate how long disaster cleanup can take and how long but victims can be isolated and restricted from health care. And a lot of victims were still sheltering in place 2 months after the storm, and some a lot longer than that. If they did find their way to emergency shelters, those shelters don't provide comprehensive care. So even if you're at an emergency shelter or even a medical shelter, there's not comprehensive care. So patients would be accountable for some portion of their health care and need to practice self-care as well. And one of the things that I talked about during the three Ps, these victims, obviously, of these homes would have to evacuate because they can't necessarily live in these homes. But when they're evacuating, even with during the time of transit, which will be talked about in detail a bit more, you know, transit sometimes can take hours, if not days, and thus these patients don't have access to health care during this time as well, so needing to take care of their chronic and acute conditions as well. And furthermore, even if you can evacuate to a place where there is access to health care, there are functioning hospitals and clinics, doesn't mean that you actually have access to them. If you have private insurance, maybe you can have some out-of-network access to health care and have that insurance company pay for the health care. But if you have public insurance and, you know, the health care system is not available to you, when you get to the new state that you may travel to or evacuate to, and you're not registered as a citizen or have residency in that state, then you wouldn't have access to health care until that's established by the government, the local government as well. So there could be extended amounts of time, even if you evacuate, that you would need to take care of yourself if you're a victim of a disaster. I wanted to illustrate when we talked about how widespread disasters can be. This is the public health care hospital system in New Orleans that was there to provide health care to citizens that didn't have, that were uninsured, and this entire health system was destroyed. during Katrina, and basically it took months to years for some services to be replaced. Basically, a satellite hospital was opened years after to replace the damaged hospital. The number of beds went from almost 1,000 to 250 beds. And this was a level one trauma center and multiple ambulatory health care centers. Basically, years after, months to years after the storm, makeshift emergency centers and health care centers were established in a local area mall to replace this entire healthcare system. So just the healthcare system itself being destroyed could cause restriction to access to healthcare as well, restricted access to healthcare. For the sake of time, I'm going to breeze through the next few slides. This is just an example of how destroyed this hospital system was. So that's a close-up of how everything had to be gutted out of that hospital, and it wasn't functional for years, and it's still not functional. It was actually permanently closed, and a new site is being currently constructed to replace it. I wanted to show you a private example as well of a private hospital. Pretty much all of the hospitals in the area were destroyed. This hospital was totally destroyed, and you can see the water lines the front door of this hospital, and so it totally had to be gutted and rebuilt. But after a few years, another private hospital system bought it and reopened it. But it took years for that to be available as well. So the healthcare system here in New Orleans is totally not fully at full capacity as before the disaster. And so there is an amount of time that we wanted to illustrate that patients would have restricted access to healthcare. I talked a little bit about the replacement of some of the services, that were destroyed, and you'll see Red Cross has a tent here, and you have all of these victims lined up to receive medical care at this tent. I mean, how much medical care and how comprehensive of care do you think that these patients would receive from this tent? And this was weeks to months post the storm that these patients only, or victims only, access to health care was this Red Cross tent. In the area that they could reach. So once again, the need for self-care is imminent. I wanted to talk a little bit about declared disasters, but just to give you some examples, but I have the information here on the slide, and just from a time standpoint, I won't go into detail about some of the declared disasters like industry-related disasters, nuclear power plants. I really wanted to illustrate how some of these disasters can be isolated events when we're looking at the three P's, but a lot of them can be widespread as well, like nuclear explosions at power plants and such. And so it could cause the same type of restriction to access to health care as some of the natural disasters that we looked at. Same thing with bombs and nuclear blasts during bioterrorist acts as well. I just gave an example here, which you have in the slides, of a train wreck where we had tons of hazardous chemicals and gases released to the atmosphere accidentally. And this particular accident affected 5,400 people in Graniteville, South Carolina, and we had 250 people that had to be treated for inhalation damage, and one actually died. And it was a long time before, 2 weeks exactly, before victims were allowed to come back into this area. So for a period of time, they had to shelter in place, and then they were allowed to leave, and then 2 weeks before they could come back. So, you know, once again, self-care is imminent, and that's just a close-up of the actual incident. One of the things that I really wanted to mention, just if you'd allow me another minute or two, was I've talked about this a little earlier, that not only would the disaster potentially restrict access to victims' access to health care, but also just generational trends and economic trends could do the same. we have a delay in retirement in the geriatric population, and they're really focused on maintaining their well-being, and they're taking care of their kids and the elderly, and in most cases can't afford to evacuate and provide, you know, get the transportation that's necessary for evacuation, you know, let alone all of the supplies and materials that they would need. And then we have the culture and social barriers that inherent that would, you know, basically motivate them to try to shelter in place as opposed to evacuating and giving up some of their independence. So the main thing here that we want to focus on is that whether it be generational trends, economic trends for the geriatric population, or just the disaster itself, there is a time frame where restricted access to health care is imminent, and thus self-care is imminent for different disasters. And I think we have a responsibility as healthcare professionals to help prepare victims of disasters to treat themselves during these time periods. And so I will pass the mic over to Dr. Gant so that she can really give us some more detailed information on how we as healthcare professionals can prepare our patients and potential victims of disasters to take care of themselves, their chronic conditions that are existing, and maybe some acute conditions that may arise during a disaster, and have them prepare themselves for that when there are no other alternatives available. So thank you for my time, and we look forward to learning some practice tips from Dr. Gant.
Thank you, Dr. Stemley. As Dr. Stemley stated, I am Kisha Gant, and today I would like to discuss with you medication and lifestyle considerations for conditions requiring management in an emergency situation. So what brings us to this point? Why are we even concerned about it? Well, approximately 80% of adults who are 65 years old or older have at least one chronic health condition. Additionally, approximately 50% of older adults have at least two chronic health conditions. So when we look at adults who are 65 years or older, we see that nearly half have hypertension, 36% arthritis, 20% coronary heart disease, 20% cancer, 15% diabetes, and 9% have had a stroke. So since I am from New Orleans and our infamous Hurricane Katrina, I will focus on that as far as some of the health and medication access statistics that occurred during that time. So when adults age 60 years and over were looked at, which actually comprised about 15% of the total population, it was found that 74% of that 60 and over population was actually part of the hurricane-related deaths. So as we see there, there's definitely a large disproportion that needs to be examined and possibly prevented in future disasters. Also, when they looked at estimated 200,000 people with chronic medical conditions who were either evacuated or isolated after the hurricane, they found that they lacked access to their medications and usual sources of care, in which Ed gave us a lot of scenarios earlier in his presentation about why that may be so. Additionally, 49% of adult evacuees who were sheltered at the Austin Convention Center arrived with acute illnesses, which also grants our need to look at management of acute illnesses also. And also, 31% had some sort of special dietary need that should have been met. More about Hurricane Katrina was that a survey was done by the Washington Post, Kaiser, and Harvard, and they surveyed 680 evacuees who lived in Houston shelters during September of 2005. What they found was that 41% had chronic health conditions such as heart disease, hypertension, diabetes, and asthma. and 43% of those evacuees indicated that they were supposed to be on some sort of prescription medication. And of those 43%, they found 29% had problems actually getting their prescriptions filled. And I know Melen gave a lot of information earlier regarding ways to access medications when you're in an emergency situation. So when we are thinking about creating these plans for our older adults, we need to look at the different types of characteristics that may actually affect our adults and make them vulnerable during disaster. So I kind of wanted to highlight a couple of them. The forced change of residence, especially if there's a mandatory evacuation, you can definitely kind of imagine in your head how that would affect the access to medication and disrupt their self-care routines. Additionally, from the access to medication, if they have a decrease in that, it's definitely going to decrease their health status and lead to them being more vulnerable. Then I know Melen also talked earlier about how poverty actually leads to an increase in a chance of your patient being less health literate. So for the purposes of this presentation, I'm going to focus more on the access to medication. So there are four phases to disaster. We have the pre-disaster phase, acute or emergency phase, post-acute phase, and the recovery phase. And as we all know, if you plan in the beginning and you do a great job at it, it'll help propel you along and make the ride smoother through the other three phases. So I'm also going to focus more on preparing during the pre-disaster phase. So when you think about helping your older adult prepare their kits when for evacuation or emergency situations, you want to think about these two scenarios in particular, that they're going to be in a shelter, and to get to that shelter, they're going to have to be in transit. So there are several different types of shelters. As Ed mentioned earlier, you have the sheltering in place where someone actually shelters in their home or maybe someone else's home. Then you have an emergency shelter, which we usually think about. People usually open the gyms at schools, and that's usually where they shelter for days to weeks. Temporary shelters are actually things such as hotels, it could be schools, it could be FEMA trailers, but it's a shorter duration of time, it's more like weeks. But when you have temporary housing, which could also be FEMA trailers, that's more like months. Which, if you've seen any pictures of Katrina, you'll see a lot of shots of the FEMA trailers still here up to a year after the disaster. Permanent replacement housing is just as it says. If you know the residence is damaged, then we definitely have to find that, and that's probably going to be more in, the last stage of the disaster phases. And then there is a medical need shelter, and that's basically for patients who are too ill to be in a shelter, but not ill enough necessarily to receive the critical care. And usually they will house the patients for up to 72 hours. And they usually do let at least one person reside there with the patient. So as you can see here, and as Ed talked about earlier, when you actually evacuate, especially the closer that you evacuate to the mandatory evacuation, the traffic is ridiculous. It may take you anywhere from 2, 3, 4 times as long as it normally would for you to reach your destination. And you also have to think about what access do you have during that time to your medications, to food, to water, gas, those basic things. So you have to think about your access to resources. And unfortunately, if you have to evacuate through a town that had a mandatory evacuation, all of the resources you may normally be able to access may be closed due to that. And also, if you're on the road, you have no idea sometimes when the next time you may be able to have access to those resources. So you have your patient, They're either going to shelter or they may be in transit to a shelter. And we need to think about how they can manage their medications during their time. And for some patients, maybe we need to look at more acute disease states. And I have listed here the ones that are more common. And for most of our patients, as we've seen in the earlier statistics, they're going to have some sort of chronic disease that's going to need to be managed. And very importantly, if the patient has a caregiver, you definitely need to include them into the discussion. So what may be different, as I described in some of those scenarios? Well, the patient's diet, their physical activity, which we know diet and exercise go hand in hand with medication to help manage patients' conditions, and also, are they going to be able to manage their medications and diseases like they would if they were at home? So diet. During Katrina, if you were still here, some of the grocery stores or whatever may not have been open. So there was a Red Cross truck going around, and most of the things it served came out of a can. So if I had high blood pressure, that's probably not the best thing for me. Also, we had the National Guard giving out MREs or meals that are ready to eat. Now, it's great because at least you have some source of food, but at the same time, they're full of fat, sodium, and calories, which we know is not good for a lot of chronic conditions. So I would definitely recommend that your patients get some kind of prepackaged non-perishable snacks that they could use to at least kind of supplement their diet and try to make it a little bit more conducive to their conditions. And actually, portion control is also very important, both during disasters, not during disasters. And you actually really want them to eat regularly, especially your diabetic patients, because we know that food definitely affects their medications. And also for those particular patients, they need to have some source of glucose to manage themselves just in case they get into an acute hypoglycemic situation. So physical activity, what are some things your patient may be able to do? Well, they may be able to walk around the shelter. Now, that's if it's permitted and it's actually accessible. So you see this picture on the slide, and that's a very crowded shelter. So you kind of have to do your best at trying to come up with ways for your patient to be able to get some sort of physical activity. Other things, weight-bearing exercises, maybe they can use their own body weight, or common objects such as they have a bottle of water or something with a little weight that they may be able to get a little exercise in. And lastly, chair exercises. They may be able to perform those efficiently in a shelter. So when we look at the self-management of their conditions and their medications, when you do their plan, you definitely want to make sure they have all the supplies that they need to take their medications and manage their diseases, the goals so they'll know that they're doing well with their management, what critical values or signs and symptoms do they need to look out for, and if they reach these values, what do they need to do for the self-management, for the self-treatment. Lastly, you need to look at medications. Now, shortage is definitely something that can happen, especially if your patient didn't do good planning in the pre-disaster phase. They definitely want to get, as far as all the literature says, 7 days worth of medication. Based on what I've seen from Katrina, I would definitely recommend if their insurance would pay for it and they're able to access it, at least a month's supply of medication. That should hold them over until they're able to access their medications. Now, even though you may have access to your medications in the shelter or some of these Red Cross tents, they may not be the same medication that you take on a normal basis because they have limited stock, and as a result, they may do some therapeutic substitutions. And especially also if you have a medication that is one of those drug shortages medication, they may not have that medication at all. So you definitely want to make sure that your patient can actually supply that for themselves. Also, alternatives. If your patient has a medication that may have some storage issues, is there an alternative medication that will efficiently manage their condition but has better storage? That's definitely something that you should think about. So, due to the sake of time and the fact that it is not possible to go through every single acute and chronic situation that could be managed during a disaster, I would just like to give you an example just to kind of show you along the lines that, you know, you should kind of be thinking when you do these plans for your patient about a type 2 diabetic patient. So when they do their prepackaged, non-perishable meals or their snacks, they need to look for foods that are complex, low carbohydrates, such as whole grains, foods that are packaged in natural juices and not that high fructose corn syrup, proteins such as nuts or canned tuna, especially canned tuna that's packaged in water. Water is important for everybody, most especially also, you know, our diabetic patients. And if you have a patient who most especially, you know, may want to change in what beverage that they're drinking, you're going to have them get their own sugar-free beverages to bring with them. Physical activity, it is recommended that adults do 150 minutes per week of physical activity. Most people break that up into 30 minutes 4 or 5 days a week. And this can also be broken down into smaller increments. So they can do 10 minutes in the morning, 10 minutes at lunch, 10 minutes in the evening. So it doesn't seem as burdensome, but they still get in their exercise for the day. And it's also recommended that older adults do weight-bearing exercise at least 2 days a week. Yoga, if they're already familiar with that and they have that memorized as far as the poses, or resistance bands, which are very portable and you don't have to look around to see what common items you have where you can actually do these exercises. So I just wanted to show some examples of some chair exercises that your patient may be able to do so they can get into some activities from the University of Missouri. Now, when you have a type 2 patient, they also need to be aware of their blood sugars before they actually exercise. So if they have blood sugars that are greater than 250 and they have ketones in their blood, they definitely want to avoid exercise. So you don't want to exacerbate your condition. Now, if their blood sugar levels are greater than 300 with no ketones, they want to use caution and be mindful that they may be on the verge of some sort of crisis. And I apologize for the slide. It should read that the levels are less than 100. So if their blood sugar levels are less than 100, it's definitely recommended that they eat some carbohydrates before they exercise so that they are not in danger of becoming hypoglycemic or have low blood sugars. So what are some supplies your patient may need? Well, they need a glucometer and all these things that go along with it so they can test their blood sugars. And if they have some sort of device that requires a needle, such as insulin, they would definitely need needles, whether it's the pen needles or the syringes, to actually administer their medication. And you definitely want to make sure they have that because you don't want them to reuse their needles because that'll put them at greater risk for infection. And we talked about earlier that they're going to need this source of glucose. So what is their goal? Well, based on the ADA, 70 to 130 if they haven't eaten, and less than 180 if they have eaten. So what are some things that they should look for to know that they're not doing well? If they have hypoglycemia, we'll talk about that later as far as staying, you know, talking about an acute condition. But hyperglycemia, they may have increased thirst, increased hunger, increased urination. Now, this, of course, would be up to the provider as to how they would like them to manage, whether they have some sort of algorithm for them to adjust their insulin or if they want to double their oral medication. Now, the caveat with that is you definitely want to put a max dose because you don't want your patients to become toxic on their medication. And also, if they consume some sugar-free fluids, that can actually help to decrease the amount of sugar, kind of make it less concentrated. So we get to medication for this type 2 patient. They have a shortage. What do you want them to do? Whether it's half a pill, every other day, whatever it is there some alternative medication you would like them to take? And as Dr. Stemley stated earlier, the older adults think that the herbals and the supplements can cause less harm and are more natural. And Dr. Oz, coming on at 4 o'clock here, does a lot of promotion of these herbals and supplements. But from the point of view of the scientific community, there really aren't studies on very many of these herbals and supplements that support their use as far as a therapeutic substance. So make sure that if your patient has questions about that, that you address those. And as far as storage, these are just general storage for oral medications and for most insulins. They want to keep them at room temperature and, most importantly, away from water, especially if they have a risk of flood or heavy rains. Insulin, most people think that once you open your insulin, you need to store it in the refrigerator, but that is not true. Most of your insulins could actually be stored at room temperature once they're open for up to a month. In the pharmacy, we usually store them in the refrigerator just to prolong their shelf life. So I just talked about a chronic condition. Now I'll go into an acute condition. So what about if your patient is hypoglycemic? What would you want them to know? Well, you would want them to know the signs and symptoms, which is very important: heart palpitations, sweating, anxiety, tremor, trouble thinking, hunger, and paresthesias. Now here I put numbness and tingling because, as Dr. McBride spoke about earlier, you want to make sure that the information you're giving your patient is at the appropriate health literacy level, not only to your patient, but to the caregiver. So you want to make sure that they understand and they're able to read and relate back everything you're talking about. So this is just a more treatment for the sake of time, how to treat this particular thing and what to do. So your patient, they're going to have this emergency kit. You want to make sure that they have the proper supplies to treat all of their conditions. If it's something that needs a battery, such as a hearing aid or glucometer, you want to make sure they have that. Eyeglasses, contact lenses, because we know if they don't have these things, they might not be able to properly manage themselves. And paper records, they're very important. During Katrina, a lot of medical establishments were destroyed and the medical records were lost forever. So make sure that your patient has this in a waterproof area, and also an emergency health information card. So if they do need access to medications, they actually have a list of them, so the pharmacist or their new physician would be able to help them get a refill. Additionally, you want this emergency kit to be portable, especially if you're going to have to leave in a quick time frame. And ideally, you might want to keep one in your car if it's not going to hurt the medications that you have, maybe at work, and definitely at home. Usually a backpack may be something good to put it in. And make sure that you review this yearly. So if you have something that needs to be refrigerated, you can actually use a little ice chest like this or one of those soft ones that's insulated. Make sure that your medication is in a waterproof packaging, and you can use ice or cool packs to keep it cool. And I just put this on here to show you an example of the information that is on an emergency health information card. I just wanted to note that the doctor and pharmacist information is on there, and also if you look at the bottom right corner, you see that we have communications, devices, equipment, other things. This is very important for patients who have things such as dementia or they have other mental conditions, maybe they're deaf, maybe they're blind, so that healthcare workers or emergency workers will be able to assist them. And we also have here one you can do online at readypa.org, and the patient, you can go in there and make it electronic and beautiful and pretty for your patient. So in summary, you want to make sure you address diet, physical activity, and medication to help your patient manage their conditions during an emergency situation, and you make sure you review your plan and check your kits annually, at least if you have any changes in your medical history, you want to do it, and make sure the caregiver is on board. And this is the case, which relates back to the one that Ed presented earlier. If you would quickly answer this, I would appreciate it. I know that we're running on time. But let's say, what would you want to do for this patient with the vision impairment and dementia? And make sure, of course, that these self-care guidelines are to the patient's health literacy level. Just because a person maybe has some sort of vision impairment doesn't necessarily mean that they have health literacy issues. Well, I would like to thank everybody for their attention. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact me. And I also have resources at the end of the slides for herbals and supplements and the Emergency Prescription Assistance Program. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time and attention.
This is Chris Matola at the Stanford GEC. This concludes our presentation today on an ethnogeriatric perspective on health literacy and medication use and emergency preparedness. I'd like to thank the presenters, Drs. Melen McBride, Edward C. Stemley, and Kisha Gant. Thank you so much for your participation.